Good afternoon and welcome to our afternoon session of WEP On Air. My name is Michelle Ponto and I am the Senior Advisor of Communications at the University. My guest today is Professor Wei Shyy, who is the Executive Vice President and Provost at the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology. He is also the Chair Professor of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering. In addition, he has a personal interest in bird watching and his observation of wing movement has aided his research in flying sensors and biological flight. Thank you for joining us today.
Welcome.
So you are an avid bird watcher. So one of the questions I have is, what is it about watching birds that you find fascinating? And was it the bird watching that led you into your field of research, or was it the other way around?
Well, I think first of all, birds are beautiful animals. You just watch them, to me at least, you feel happy, okay? But to me, since I started to watch birds mainly for the interest of trying to understand and appreciate how they fly. I'm interested in seeing birds of all kinds, but when they perch, I'm not as interested in seeing them when they are in the air. I think one of the main reasons is since my own expertise is in aerospace engineering, I study how a subject matter can stay airborne. And the birds are fundamentally different from the airplanes that we know. Since by definition, we know that they move by flapping the wing, but more importantly, by trying to synchronize how the wing move between the two and between wing and the tail, okay? And this, for airplane, certainly for airplane which carry passengers, is not practical. Because airplane cannot flap the wing to generate thrust. The structural will not, mechanical will not allow that. When a vehicle like bird becomes smaller, then the beautiful thing is it can provide lift by flapping. It also simultaneously provides thrust. So unlike engine, unlike the airplane, you have the wing plus the engine. Here, the birds have got a pair of wings. It basically, they can move forward, sideways, and certainly move up and down, but just by flapping, it's the same pair of wings. So I think that is a very interesting phenomenon, and to me and to many of my fellow researchers in the field, it has enriched our understanding tremendously.
Do you look at the birds differently depending on if they are small birds or larger birds and how that does affect aerospace
yes.
dynamics?
I think the larger birds and small birds are quite different fundamentally. If you look at the larger birds, for example, the larger ones such as albatross, it in fact needs to run quite a few steps to try to run fast, then before it can become airborne. Because it's heavier, you really need to gain enough speed, and by flapping alone, it cannot generate enough of the lift. For a smaller bird, sparrow, finch, hummingbird, they can take off essentially instantaneously because their body is much lighter. Relatively speaking, the wing areas actually are much more substantial. Okay, so between larger and small birds, they operate very differently. And also the wing movement pattern of the wing movement is quite different. Okay, if you look at larger birds, they actually, if possible, they like to take advantage of the thermal. Once they go up, they will circle around, and they will try to use air current to help them continue to stay airborne. So albatross, oftentimes, once they take off, they can stay airborne for a long, long time, because once they land, to go up, it takes a lot of energy. For smaller birds, on the other hand, they can go and come and go very easily. And they also typically don't really stay in the air that much unless they migrate, okay? Even smaller birds like hummingbird can migrate from north to south or vice versa easily for hundreds of miles without stopping, okay? So the movement of the wing, the shape of the wing, they have a very strong correlation to the size of the birds.
Okay. So looking at these different correlations in birds, how can this be used in research?
Because fundamentally, I think these days, birds, to many of us, interested in studying flight vehicles, they can be considered as a flying sensor, okay? They don't have enough of the payload capabilities, okay? But they can fly from point A to point B or with any of the instantaneous adjustment. A, they are very agile. B, with the miniaturization of the sensor actuation and the information technologies nowadays, we human can now build bird size, even small bird size, or even insect size of the flight vehicles with reasonably capable sensors that can be chemical sensors, can be cameras, can also have some kind of thermal imaging capabilities. So for example, you can have these kind of smaller flying sensor to detect in the case of nuclear accident. It is not a good idea for human to go there to, even though you are protected, shielded, it's still not very comfortable. So you can potentially fly some of these to a disastrous area. The other thing which is very commonly employed nowadays is for environmental monitoring. For air pollution, for example, you can really go quite, cover a good area. And if there is another interest, for example, people start to use rotating wing, not quite flapping wing yet, to do cable inspection to see whether you don't have to, whether you can avoid using human to do all the inspection, which can be very laborious and tedious, and not necessarily very safe. Okay, so there are many these kind of possibilities to use sensors to monitor a variety of the information that you like to monitor. And also, it can also have a possibility that if you have a number of sensors, they can go out to coordinate with each other, each one potentially performing different function. And then altogether, this integrated, which we call swarm, can give you a very rich set of information that you otherwise will find very difficult to collect.
That's interesting. When I do think of flight, I often do think of things that are in the air, like planes and
yes.
and drones or whatever. But there are other applications that the WEP movement can be used, such as power generation
yes.
and other parts. Tell me a little bit about these other areas of research.
Because whether it is efficient to flap the wing, or to rotate the wing, or to have some other movement, it really, first of all, depend on the size of the wing. If you have a larger windmill, for example, you just rotate the wing because that is by far more efficient. But in some cases, again, flapping fundamentally it is associated with birds, insects, bats, and they tend to be small and localized, individualized. So you can have some of the highly efficient, I think, devices which can derive energy from local sources. For example, you can potentially use solar energy, even biological energy source. Okay, these are some of the very highly, I think, pursued topics. If you station some of the local smaller devices to do some of the tasks that I mentioned earlier, you can potentially generate enough power by its own devices, and then to do different tasks without being refueled. Okay, so I think we are talking about potentially a variety of the different platforms. They can also, some perched, some on the wall, some flying out, and they can have visual, they can have audio, they can have chemical sensing capabilities. They all, so I think we are not quite there yet, but the direction is to see that we can derive energy sources from local supply. Okay, so these are all, I would say, within the next few years can become feasible.
Okay. How big would these have to be to be able to generate energy? Would they be able to do it on a small scale, or would it need to be a big?
I think you don't have to have a large scale, because the requirement is also very much proportional to the size. They cannot generate energy to supply human need. But for them, if you look at, say, a small insect, their energy consumption is directly related to how much they need to flap the wing, which is really very much dependent on the wing size and the body. The body is reduced even faster in terms of weight compared to the wing size. Okay, so that is feasible, and there is this very strong possibility, I would say, which can convert energy from source like plant. Okay, look at the bee. They basically derive energy from the flowers, okay, essentially sugar. Okay, hummingbirds basically just drink from sweet water, right? And that, if you can have the energy conversion capabilities, that is very quick to turn sweetness into performance.
That's interesting. So a lot of the technology that's being developed in other areas will aid this technology as well. As cameras get lighter, as solar energy gets better, it could be transformed.
Yes, that is actually a very important key point, because 20 years ago, I would say this kind of small flying machine are very hard to realize, because we didn't have that kind of materials. We didn't have that kind of capabilities to fabricate. We also didn't have that kind of small size, fast response microchips, okay, which can compute with so little power requirement. Now many things in terms of the hardware, in terms of materials, in terms of energy power generation, they all converge. And we are in a new era in terms of the fly vehicle. Okay, so that, I think, gives us, more than just aerospace engineers, I think because the subject matter is a biological, I think it's from biology. And many biologists now collaborate with aerospace engineers to study this. And that also fundamentally created a truly interdisciplinary opportunity for us to work together, because we have different expertise. We also need to learn from each other, since a lot of things we don't know because of the limitation of the original training.
That's true. Not everyone is a bird watcher like you, so they're not going to see how you see things.
Well, I think that's, since I heard that there are many birds here now, I think it's around the campus, I think that kind of opportunity will simply grow.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So tell me about something, one of the innovations that are coming out of this this new technology that you're excited about or perceived are coming out soon?
I think right now, for example, we have a certain threat in terms of the security. On the one hand, drones are becoming very commonly used. There's also concern about privacy, security, and many other things. And it is not easy to monitor all the time, because of the size are not too large, but they are not too small either. They can do certain things that maybe we do not want to see. So I think some of these smaller flying vehicles, since they have a much smaller payload, they can be deployed with very little effort. I think that can give us, if you picture this from an insect size of the flapping wing vehicle to some smaller to larger bird size, to rotating wing drone size, then all the way to, you can see we have multiple layers of many different kind of flying platform. Mm-hmm. And on a positive side, they can integrate and collaborate, okay? They can potentially give us information we otherwise would not be able to tell, because they're too localized, too small, too many different varieties. On the other hand, if we have some of these smaller flapping wing type of vehicle, they potentially can also be deployed to do advanced warning. And that, I think, can help enhance certain community security and safety concern. Okay, that can also give, on the other hand, also give people interest in machine by itself. The joy of flying some toys. Okay, the toys probably is as large a domain as anything else also. So you see both personal entertainment all the way to some of the highly integrated functionality that can be provided by such vehicles.
That's interesting, but it's also a sign that this is a successful technology, that it could be a toy all the way to something that changes the way or saves the world.
Yes, I think that's very much a trademark of modern day technology. It can truly be used in many different ways, and it is up to us to figure out how to best optimize the purpose. And in the meantime, we also need to have certain policy to make sure the risk is mitigated.
What kind of policies do you need? Do you think need to come into play?
Because I think, first of all, the security, cybersecurity, and the privacy, these are first and foremost, in my view, are very, very basic. We are in an era that very many things are ubiquitous. They are everywhere. And you cannot just regulate. You also need to, first of all, need to have policy to clearly articulate what is proper, what is not proper. Then to support the policy, you need to have science and technology. Otherwise, you simply cannot follow up to enforce the policy or law. So I think right now we are seeing this a very clear need to see the science and technology and the law and the policy, they need to be integrated. Okay, I think that is a very big topic. And flapping wing is just one of the examples. There are many other areas that you can see because of very fast, amazing advancement in science and technology. Many of the policy domain not long ago was not thinkable, but now it becomes real and immediate. So I think that is a very important area which for a technology oriented university that need to be addressed also, because it is fundamentally more than just policy for policies, public policy sake. It is very much rooted and motivated by the advancement in science and the technology.
It's just, it's almost where the policy, the creators behind the technology need to be involved with.
Exactly, that's exactly my point. I think there needs to be a very close collaboration between scientists, engineers, and the policy analyst and even lawmaker. Okay, it cannot be separated anymore.
Okay, that's also another change. So the technology is changing, and the way the policy is going to be made needs to be changed. Perception needs to be changed.
Precisely. So
precisely. A lot of little things have to happen.
Yes.
But it's happening quickly.
It is very fast, and that's also why we need to be very. Hopefully, we can stay ahead of the curve. Okay, instead of responding to the situation. And that, I think, takes a more advanced research to be able to uncover and identify the need before it becomes too late.
Okay. That's right. Do you find that there is pressure to escalate the technology behind it because it is so exciting and there's so much possibilities for it?
It is for sure, because the enthusiasm is clear. In the older days, when we talk about bigger airplane, people can only do paper design. Very few people can flight test and to realize their concept. Now with the smaller flight vehicles, flapping wing included, you can literally produce multiple different types of versions that you would like to try. So the turnaround time, the experimentation is so much more accelerated and so much more accessible. So I think that is why we are in a different kind of time, that the advancement is only going to accelerate and become more diverse. And hence, the collaboration, it is even more essential.
It has taken a long time to get to this point because we've been flying for years.
Yes.
Birds have been around for a long time.
Yes.
We've had cameras, we've had sensors. Why did it take so long and what is pushing it forward, escalating it now?
I think the most fundamental thing is because of the capability of miniaturizing the technology. The materials become lighter, the functionality can be offered with much smaller scale, power source becomes much more localized, the information computing technologies can be done in such a small, confined, I think, chips, for example. And now a mobile phone can perform the computing capabilities more than a supercomputer just 15, 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. So all these are moving at an amazing speed. Okay, so I think because of all this together, they can mutually influence each other. And consequently, they created a situation that was unprecedented not long ago.
Okay. I think we're going to take, we have a number of people in the audience. We're going to take some questions from you. Anybody have any questions?
We have one question from Facebook, actually.
Excellent.
From Ibrahim. He's asking, what are the materials that make synthetic flapping wings possible?
I think largely you need to make the material soft. The larger wing can be more rigid. And if you look at just compare an eagle and a hummingbird, if you look at the way the wing flaps, you can see that eagles, they are all soft fundamentally. But eagles, when they fly, they rely far less in terms of the shape change of the wing. The wing change is a platform, but it doesn't change so much in terms of the cross section. A hummingbird, on the other hand, just between the forward stroke and the backward stroke, the wing, the camber, can change upside down. Okay, so I think that in part simply because when you have smaller wing, it naturally becomes thinner and hence becomes more flexible. But from the flight dynamics viewpoint, it is also very important because it makes the wing more controllable and hence can be more adaptive in producing close to optimal kind of performance. Okay, so the materials need to be softer and softer.
Any other questions from the audience?
That's all we have from Facebook at the moment. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. I have another question for you.
Sure.
I'm just curious, because you watch birds, you've written so many books on aerodynamics and lots of papers. When you go out bird watching and you're seeing it through the scientist's eyes, what do you see?
First of all, I feel relaxed. When I see them, they're just joy to watch. And that is my most probably important pastime outside work. And many times I go with my wife, and she actually, a lot of times she has better eyes, sharper eyes. She will identify the object. Then I see, then the important thing is that you learn how to kind of collaborate with birds, because they don't like to be photoed. They like to be private, and when you have a camera pointed at them, they are not sure what to do with you. And hence, you need to learn how to anticipate their movement. So I think that also is a very rewarding experience when you, hopefully you can guess when they are going to take off. Because as I mentioned, I'm more interested in taking picture and observing them when they are in the air. And when you see sometimes because of wind gust or because of their flight pattern, sometimes the wing can exhibit very remarkable shape and the movement that you don't usually see. I think that is fundamentally beautiful, okay, to see how they can integrate the form shape together to deliver what they need to perform. Okay, it is really a true integration of art and effective design. Okay, for engineers, I think that's the highest form of performance.
Yeah, that sounds wonderful. Yes. I think I might have to take up bird watching myself.
Yes, I think it's worth it. Okay.
What got you into it? Like, how old were you and why? What spurred it on?
I think since I was interested in studying flight when I was in college. And it is also accidental. You see birds all the time. You don't necessarily pay attention to them because they are so common. I remember this was when I was in college. Once I saw a book. It was a book published by a British natural photographer. The book was published in the probably 70s, I think. At that time, there was no digital camera. It is extremely challenging to take a nice, clear, high-quality shot since you don't really know where birds or insects are going to fly to. And this book, I think it's called Born on the Wing. I still remember that book. This author was remarkable, I think. He shot several pictures to see an insect landed on a leaf. It's so clear, so beautiful. See the wing shape. I think that was just fantastic. And that was one of the things I always remember. At that time, it was difficult and you have to have, fundamentally for this kind of a photography, you need to have big lens. Okay, fast shutter speed. So you need to invest on the equipment. Later on, when I was able to afford it, that became really a fun thing. And also, since it was really natural to support my research, that can be my good excuse to invest on the equipment, right?
That's excellent. If there's no more questions, I think we have had a great interview. I'm going to be definitely looking at birds different, and next time I'm in a plane or I see a drone, I'll be thinking of birds. I'll be seeing it in a different perspective.
I think you won't be disappointed. No. You will enjoy it. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.